This is Bambu Lab's latest 3D printer release, the P2S. It's the refresh of their very popular P1S, which in my opinion was for quite a while the best bang for your buck enclosed 3D printer on the market. In this video, we'll take a look at what they improved, where it even falls short of its predecessor, and why the P2S makes the X1 Carbon completely obsolete. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is sponsored by Voxel PLA, more on them later. So many were expecting to see Bambu Lab's nozzle changer, the H2C, as their next release, but almost out of nowhere, they started introducing the first overhaul of one of their existing machines. And it's not the X2 Carbon as I was expecting, but a refresh of their mid-range P-Series. So here are the main specs for the impatient, and if you appreciate that, consider leaving a like. The P2S is not a revolution, but a nice refresh. It's a mid-sized printer with the familiar 256x256x256mm print volume and a bed with a spring steel sheet capable of reaching 110 degrees Celsius. The printhead features a 300 degrees Celsius hardened steel hotend with quick swappable nozzles. It's controlled by a 5-inch touchscreen, and the internal HD camera can detect print failures or problems automatically. The P2S combo, available at launch, includes the AMS 2 Pro, which features a built-in drying function. The P2S is also compatible with the AMS HT and the original AMS 1, allowing up to 20 colors in one project. Performance and print quality was great in my tests, but I noticed some VFAs at lower printing speeds. They have a really innovative cooling and hot air recirculation system in this machine, but I hate that they don't filter the exhaust air anymore when printing PLA or PETG. US pricing and availability are currently still unclear due to the changing tariffs, but the base pricing in Europe at the time of release is 519 euros for the standalone printer and 749 euros for the combo, which is pretty much what the old one cost as well before. For up-to-date pricing and availability, check the links in the description. They also helped me produce these videos. If you have a specific question, put them in the comments and I'll try to answer them as soon as possible. Before we dive into all the details, let's quickly talk about today's video sponsor, Voxel PLA. I'm sure you know them because I'm constantly using their materials here in the studio. In fact, most of the prints I did for this review were made with their filaments. They offer a wide range of colors, are inexpensive, work flawlessly with any multi-material system, and they even offer free shipping in the US on orders over $75. This time, I really want to highlight their new gorgeous flip-flop colored Galaxy PETG Plus. The sparkles and the shine are so good at hiding layer lines and surface artifacts that I couldn't even use it for my print quality tests. I just wouldn't have seen any issues. Voxel PLA only made a limited run of 4 colors, so grab yours while they still have it in stock. They also made a special discount code for viewers of this channel, and the first 200 customers can save an additional 10% on anything using code GALAXYKITCHEN on orders over $100. And if others already grabbed the nice Galaxy PETG, just stock up on their regular PETG Plus High Speed, their super reliable PLA Plus High Speed, or their other 3D printing accessories. Thanks to Voxel PLA for sponsoring this video. So let's jump into the juicy details and find out what changed, what improved, and why some things got worse. If you put the old P1S and the new P2S side by side, you can clearly see the difference. Not only did they get rid of the dark gray panels I loved so much on the P1S and preferred over the silver look of the X1, but you can also see that they replaced the dot matrix LED screen with a nice responsive touchscreen featuring the same second generation UI as the big H2 printers, though at a slightly lower resolution. The housing has also been refined with hand pockets for easier carrying, flexible rubber feet for vibration decoupling, and a side-mounted spool holder instead of the one in the back, making loading and unloading filament spools that don't fit the AMS far more convenient. Another neat detail is that the filament buffer now comes with 2 ports by default, so you no longer need to swap Bowden tubes when switching between AMS and external spool printing. You can even connect 2 AMS units directly for 8-color printing without extra accessories. But let's look inside, where the more significant changes are. First of all, one thing they didn't upgrade are the door hinges. While the larger H printers let you open the front door 180 degrees, the P2 still only opens around 110 degrees, which can be annoying if you're working in a tight space. Inside, the bed remains 256 by 256 millimeters, and the print height is also still the same. But you get a bit more usable space, because it now also has one of these mechanically retractable filament cutter actuators. This means you no longer lose the small unusable front corner unless you tape the cutter back. A nice and convenient improvement. Once you take your eyes off the bed, you'll spot one of the other major big updates. The guide rods of the printhead are now made from steel again. The first generation machines used carbon fiber rods. Lightweight, stiff, and a bit of a brag factor. But not everyone liked them because they feared that they wear out quickly. But it seems Bambu Lab didn't sacrifice speed from the extra weight, because print speeds and accelerations are still on par or even faster than on the X1 and P1S. The other major change is the tool head, which looks similar on the outside but is completely new. The P2S now also has the same quick swap nozzle system as the H and A series printers. The hot end is clipped in place and can be removed easily after taking off the silicone sock. No cables need to be unplugged. By default, it comes already with a hardened steel nozzle, so you don't need to purchase a special one for abrasive filaments. They again look very similar to the ones from the A-series printers, but have a slightly longer melt zone for higher melting capability. The extruder gears are also hardened, but more interesting is the servo motor driving the extruder. This provides a lot of extrusion power in a compact form factor, and the feedback data can be used to detect grinding or jamming filament, which is something only Bambu Lab does right now. You might have already noticed that the build chamber looks a bit brighter than before. And that's because they finally added proper lighting with two internal LED bars. This not only makes monitoring the prints easier, but also greatly improves the camera image. The new camera is full HD and records at a decent frame rate, a big step up from the low-res 1 frame per second feed on the old machines, to be honest. It also handles AI spaghetti detection, which can be handy, though I found it a bit overly sensitive, causing some false positives during testing. But you can always tune it down or disable it entirely. From what I have observed, the camera also performs build plate detection. The new print plates look slightly different, with a bigger and way more contrasty data matrix printed on it, so it can be clearly read from the side-mounted camera. This seems like DRM, but it's actually useful to ensure that the build plate selected in your slicer matches the one installed, or that the plate is installed at all. Trust me, that happens. And you can still use your own plates, but you'll be missing out on that feature. Another big change is the cooling system, which I haven't seen like that on any other machine. When printing PLA in enclosed printers, the air inside can get too warm, causing cooling problems and even the filament softening in the PTFE tube. On older Bambu printers, you were advised to leave the door open. The H2 series has a top vent flap, and others even recommend sliding the top lid open. The P2S takes a smarter approach here. The large side cooling fan draws in cool air from the outside and prevents overheating that way. When printing high temperature materials like ABS, ASA, or polycarbonate, an internal flap closes that vent and the printer then recirculates the air through a carbon filter in the back, reducing particulates, VOCs, and odors. It's not a heated chamber, but this system still rises the internal temperature to around 50 degrees Celsius or more when the bed is at 100 to 110 degrees Celsius. We've talked about tons of specs, but not yet about the most important thing: how it prints. Over the past few weeks, I've tested it with a wide range of materials: PLA, PETG, TPU, ASA, nylon, and carbon fiber reinforced polycarbonate. Besides a few false positive failure detections, filament running out, and supports detaching, every project seriously finished flawlessly. That's partly definitely thanks to the nozzle bed leveling system that produces amazing first layers, and their golden texture PEI sheets, which grip well when hot but release easily when cool. Print quality is mostly really excellent. The 3D Banshee came out nearly perfectly, consistent extrusions, and great overhangs. Only the smokestack diameter varies slightly when slowing down at lower layer times. The ASA Banshee showed more of a hull line distortion, but that's material shrinkage and not really the printer. Clock Springs Torture Toaster also printed great. 4 of the 5 pins were loose, down to the 0.2 mm gap. Small details looked sharp, Layers stacked up beautifully and overhangs were good, though the P2S doesn't quite match the H2D's cooling performance. Even multicolor prints came out flawlessly, despite heavy waste. No color bleed, perfect alignment, and no failures, even when using a normal AMS alongside an AMS HT to print a 5-color model. Yet I wouldn't be German if I didn't complain about something. When printing a protective case for my positron glass bed that I took on holiday with me, I noticed subtle surface patterns on the x-direction faces, similar to VFAs, so vertical fine artifacts. They vary with speed and were especially visible at lower speeds, 60 mm per second by default. Printing at 80 mm a second largely removed them, so I think this can likely be fixed with profiles or firmware. This is a phenomenon you see on many printers, but here it stood out particularly on these flat parts. Otherwise, there's barely anything to complain about in terms of print quality. I'm seriously happy with the results. But since I'm already being that grumpy German guy, let's continue. There's one other thing I really don't like, and that's the air filtration. When printing high temperature materials, the warm air is filtered, which is great. But when printing PLA or PETG, fresh cool air is blown inside, but since there's no filtered exhaust, everything simply escapes through gaps in the housing. I might be overly sensitive, but even PLA can emit noticeable odors, especially during material changes or when printing with specific PLA plus materials. Studies show that printing any material releases particulates and gases I'd rather not breathe. That's why I celebrated when Bambu had the exhaust filter on the X1 Carbon, something many others later copied. So this feels to me like a step backward, and I hope they reconsider this for future machines. When I filmed the B-roll yesterday, I noticed there's actually a mount for a second auxiliary fan on the left side, which is currently unpopulated, and also a cover on the bottom. That could be a perfect spot to add an exhaust filter, either inside or by attaching a large one on the outside, which could be a nice mod. The other minor issue is the heated bed. Judging from the heating pattern, it again uses rod-style heaters instead of a PCB or a silicone mat, causing temperature unevenness across the plate. It's fine for small prints, but could cause adhesion issues on larger parts that go all the way to the corners. Though, out of fairness, I have to say I didn't have a single bed adhesion problem during my tests. But I mean, enough complaining, let's talk about the things that I really like. This refresh brings a bunch of new features, but focuses on making the machine even easier to use. You notice that they used their machine, sat down and tried to fix any inconvenience there was. This starts with the quick swap nozzles, the print sheet alignment mechanism, a smooth transition to the edge of the bottom panel so that you can easily clean out all the purge lines everyone just tosses there, all the way to the side-mounted spool holder and a filament buffer that directly has two inputs for an AMS and the side spool holder. And all the tubes and plugs are easily swappable. Overall, you can tell Bambu Lab focused on polish and convenience, not reinvention. And that's great for this machine. So now you've heard all about the features. Things like the touchscreen, hardened steel nozzle and gears used to be the differentiating feature between the X1 and the P1 in the past. But now with the P2S, the X1 just completely becomes obsolete. There's basically nothing besides the 120 degrees Celsius bed on the US version that the X1 still does better. So if you're considering getting an X1, don't. Get the P2S instead. It's more up to date and a better value. But this also brings up the question if there will be an X1 refresh, and if so, what differentiating features will it have? Nozzle changer, heated chamber, or something completely new? Let me know your speculations in the comments. Let's finally talk about the polarizing ecosystem, the reason some people love Bambu Lab and others avoid it like the plague. Bambu Lab is becoming the Apple of 3D printing. They offer a tightly integrated ecosystem where everything just works, and that brought countless new people into the hobby. Even my wife is now printing her own models after I installed Bambu Handy on her phone. But if you want to step outside the ecosystem, things get tricky. They've disabled direct communication with third-party slicers, so with Orca Slicer, you either have to copy the G-code to a USB drive or use their Bambu Connection app, which is a pain, and I noticed that myself while testing. But for 99% of users, this isn't a problem, since Bambu Studio works great and lacks few features, but I understand why some find it so restrictive. If you want full control, your own slicer, custom firmware, and no cloud dependency, the P2S or any other Bambu Lab printer isn't for you. You're better off with a competition or DIY builds, but often at the cost of convenience. But if you're looking for a medium-sized, enclosed, fire-and-forget machine that prints most of the materials with minimal hassle, the P2S might be a worthy successor to the bang-for-your-buck king. If you, by the way, consider upgrading, the main benefits you'll get are convenience and the ability to print more materials due to the hotter bed and the hardened steel hotend and extruder. If you're new to 3D printing, it's definitely a solid and capable option, and especially the convenience might be the reason for getting one. The market is more competitive these days, with QIDI, Eligu and others offering similar value, often at a lower price. Even though Bambu Lab often leads in innovation, they don't always offer the most features per dollar. You'll find hotter nozzles, heated chambers, or even tool changers elsewhere, but most lack the tight integration. Just like Apple, what you pay for here is a polished machine and the seamless experience, the fact that the 3D printer is the tool and not the project. Not that I say that a 3D printer project is something bad, but I think you know what I mean. But let me know your thoughts in the comments. Do you think the P2S is a worthy successor to the P1, or were you expecting more changes? And if I helped you in your purchasing decision, I'd appreciate it if you used the links down in the description. Buying through them doesn't cost you extra, but helps me keep the lights on here in the studio. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video interesting. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon or become a YouTube member. Also, check out the other videos in my library. I hope to see you in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye.